Welcome to the World Beyond Belief. This is Paul Marco, and I'll be here for the entire time. With me today again is Eric Karlstrom. Now, how this interview got together is after we did a last interview on music, we realized that we left out a lot of content. So we're here to give a part two to our music as a cultural influence in the United States. And we're two people who have been very influenced by music. And so we're probably experts. So welcome, Eric. Welcome to the World Beyond Belief. I'm looking forward to a great conversation.
Well, thank you, Paul. It's really nice to be able to continue this particular conversation. I think we were just getting kind of revved up last time. And both of us were, you know, thinking of this and thinking of that needs to be, you know, added. This is, I think, a very important and huge subject. And if you don't mind, right now I've got a music website of my own. It's called erickarlstrom.com. And I've been playing guitar since I was 13 and trombone since I was 9. And
wow.
My mother's father was from Wales, where, of course, you know, singing is the national pastime. And he won the National Eisteddfod at the age of 17, which means he was the best baritone in the country. Which means, you know, I mean, that's like winning the Super Bowl in Wales.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I got some genes from both sides that are quite musical. And I've been playing ever since, guitar, banjo, piano, and singing. And, of course, I personally made a record when I was 17. And my dad was you know, underwrote the thing. It was a little 45 RPM. They got to be number 20 in Phoenix back in 1968.
All right.
And of course, 1968 was when everything started going crazy, right? I mean, 1968 was one of those pivotal years in the entire generation of the baby boomers, of which we are representatives. And so I went on into academics, but I always kept playing music and always have, you know, felt it was a really important part of who I am, and still is. And now that I'm retired from being a geography professor, I'm working more and more on my music. I'm trying to become the banjo player of my dreams, which is quite a challenge. And right now, my music site, erickarlstrom.com, is being updated as we speak. So it's going to be really cool in a few days with, you know, calendars and YouTubes and things like that. I'm going to struggle into the technology that you guys seem to have done so well at mastering. but I wanted to just start off a little bit this time with, in 1990, I wrote a book an article for a Catholic journal called Desert Call. And my friends in Crestone, the Carmelite Catholics, had a very nice little magazine. And I wrote an article called Marking the Music, the Demons Behind the Noise. And this is a while ago now, 1990. And when we, in that article, I was trying to come to grips with some of these issues. And I quoted a number of wise guys on the topic of music. And let me just, if you don't mind, read a couple of these kind of inspiring quotes. Thomas Carlyle said, "Music is well said to be the speech of angels. In fact, nothing among the utterances allowed to man is felt to be so divine. It brings us near to the infinite." Okay, well, let me read a couple more. Victor Hugo, 1802 to 1885, stated, "Music expresses that which cannot be put into words and that which cannot remain silent." I've heard this kind of paraphrased, music begins where words leave off. And I would tend to agree. And this is one of the reasons I've always loved music, for expressing yourself. You know, there's something more than just, you know, rational words going on. Carlyle in 19, he was living in the 1800s. He said, "Music is a kind of inarticulate, unfathomable speech, which leads to the edge of the infinite. Okay, that's more or less very similar to what we heard. Pythagoras, 2,500 years ago, said the highest goal of music is to connect one's soul to their divine nature, not entertainment, he says. John Paul, O music, thou who bringest the receding waves of eternity nearer to the weary heart of man as he stands upon the shores and longs to cross over, art thou the evening breeze of life or the morning air of the future one? Well, that's a nice poetic expression of it.
Right.
Plato, you know, the Republic, back at 4 centuries before Christ, said, harmony sinks deep into the recesses of the soul and takes its strongest hold there, bringing grace also to the body and mind as well. Body, mind, and soul. Music is a moral law. It gives a soul to the universe, wings to the mind, flight to the imagination, a charm to sadness, and life to everything. It is the essence of order.
Interesting, are great, yeah.
These quotes, you know, tell us what music can, I think, and should be. I mean, it can really lift us up. It can really pull us up. And of course, great church music through the years. You know, guys like Beethoven and Bach, they understood the power of music. So it has this very powerful potential, but I think it also is a double-edged sword.
Right.
And last time we talked about how music had been, you know, used really to bring in some very, very dark, even satanic influences, especially into our baby boomer generation back in the 60s and 70s,
yeah,
when everything seemed shift. Now,
right.
I was down at a La Puente thrift store in Alamosa a couple days ago looking through the old records. And I love to, you know, kind of peek through the old record bins. And a lot of these were very old records from the 40s and 50s. A lot of church music.
Right.
A lot of Christian music, a lot of beautiful choir music. And that seemed to be the staple back in the 40s and 50s. And then, of course, popular music, you know, the top 40 and everything got going, you know, in the 50s and 60s, especially right after World War II. Things got, you know, the folk music scene you and I were involved in. I started playing guitar in this, you know, in the early, mid-60s when the Kingston Trio and Peter, Paul, and Mary
Me
were
too.
Going strong.
Me too.
And all the campuses had these great, you know, folk groups, the Journeymen I'm sure you can remember some of them, the New Christy Minstrels.
Oh, yeah.
And the Brothers Four and all these great folk groups that people loved. And Hoot Nannies were big on campus, and it got people singing, and it got people, you know, having fun singing, you know, in their own living rooms. And, of course, within a couple years of that, maybe 66, 67, 68, as the war in Vietnam cranked up and got ugly and our friends and relatives started coming home in
body bags
or maimed, the music got real ugly. And it got progressively uglier, and of course up to this present time. And I think we noticed in our last conversation that it went over into the dark side. And this, you know, was this just all a big coincidence or not is kind of the interesting question I'd like to pursue today. But before we pursue that question, let me just read a couple quotes on the dark side of
Good.
Music, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
Again, quoting from this excellent DVD video that's put together by a Christian pastor named Joe Schimmel, who himself was in the rock scene until he realized what was going on and that he was actually channeling lyrics from perhaps demon spirits.
Right.
You know, he just opened himself up and here they came. He was the channel. He didn't even know what all the words meant. He had to look them up. So here's some quotes. Here's DMX, a rap singer. Since I run with the devil, I am one with the devil. I sold my soul to the devil, and the price was cheap. Well, I mean, that's, you know, it's not ambiguous, is it?
No.
Black Sabbath, Ozzy Osbourne said, I didn't know if I don't know if I'm a medium for some outside source. Frankly, I hope it's not what I think it is, Satan. And of course, he does these songs to Satanist Aleister Crowley.
Aleister Crowley, yeah.
Yeah, and then when you start to see these, you know, clips, video clips of these huge rock concerts, and the crowd just going berserk, you know, throwing their clothes off and all waving and jumping and bumping and giving this sign of the horns.
I mean,
my God, these are gigantic Bacchanal Satan worshiping events. It's what they are.
Right.
This is our culture. You know what happened? Let me read a couple more. There's so many people that we're very familiar with. Kurt Cobain, of course, was the front man for Nirvana, who died of supposedly suicide. You know, advocating getting stoned and worshiping Satan. Metallica sang a song, "Angel from Below, Change My Dreams." I wait for glory's hour, for wealth's esteem. I wish to sell my soul to be reborn. I wish for earthly riches. Don't want no crown of thorns. Devil take my soul, with diamonds you repay, blah, blah, blah. I don't care for heaven, so don't you look for me to cry. I will burn in hell from the day I die. These guys are idiots. Well, they've made the deal. They've signed up.
That's
the
right.
Line. They've said, okay, I will take earthly wealth. I will take riches. I want to be somebody. I want that most beautiful woman, or I want that most beautiful jet plane or whatever.
Right.
And I don't care what happens after I die, you know. This is so sad.
It's sad.
Course, all of these figures are extremely influential to lots and lots of young people.
Exactly.
And I think that's not a coincidence. Here's what Anton LaVey said, the founder of the Church of Satan back in 1966. He said, "Today's satanic bands are the vehicle of choice for millions of young people. Satan has always had the best tunes. Music can inspire people to murder or violence, to shoot a mall full of people." Wow. So, you know, there you have it. You can, you know, reach to the heights with music, according to Plato and Beethoven and all these Carlyle guys. And then what we have with our popular rock music now is just exactly the opposite.
Yeah.
So the question is, I suppose, how do we get from here to here, where the culture was, say, American culture? We can talk about American culture, even though you're in Ecuador, Paul. You spend.
I'm an American. American culture's in me.
That's right. You are an embodiment
of the American culture.
A timeline. You're a history. You're a repository.
I'm a long timeline. I'm a long.
Me too. So then the question is, what happened? And we did some talking last time about the Frankfurt School, which is the school of social research that started up in Frankfurt, Germany in 1923, and became the site where a whole bunch of sociologists and psychologists tried to extend the revolution of the Marxist communist revolution and to extend it into the society gradually. They realized that the rest of the world wasn't, you know, dropping like dominoes like this Russia after the communist revolution there. So they figured, well, we're going to have to rethink this. We're going to have to figure out how to infiltrate into the cultures and change them from inside.
Right.
You know, and we're going to do it culturally. So you have these very, very bright individuals in the 20s in Germany. Almost all of them are Jewish, by the way, and they are planning techniques then that can shift the society, do a paradigm shift in society, and Hitler kicked them out in 1933.
Right.
Well, what happened? They went right to England and America. They
New
went
York.
To Columbia.
Right.
They went to New York. And then that particular infection, really, I think we can map it out. We can say, well, this is what happened in the 60s.
Right.
It's the ideas of these Frankfurt school guys. Now, here's a book by Daniel Estulin about the Tavistock Institute. It's called Tavistock Institute, Social Engineering the Masses. Well, of course, Tavistock was heavily staffed by people from the Frankfurt School and
Absolutely.
People like Sigmund Freud. And so if you don't mind, if
no.
I just
go
on a roll here, I'll just read a little bit out of this book.
I like that book, by the way. I would advocate it for anybody who wants to catch up on Tavistock. Daniel is a little bit better writer than John Coleman, and his stuff is a little bit more... John is great, great researcher and great information, but Daniel was easier for me to read, just for whatever
yes,
it's worth.
I think this is an astonishing book, the Tavistock Institute. It came out in 2015 by Daniel Estulin. He calls it an anti-brainwashing combat manual.
Cool.
In other words, we, especially we boomers, you know, who were plunked down in front of, you know, Walt Disney with our mouse ears when we were 4 years old.
That's right.
And we the TV was just, you know, kind of downloaded. That whole hypnosis was downloaded mm-hmm. into our minds. He says that we are the most propagandized version of, you know, generation in history in America. And it's not accidental. There was a design behind it. And the design, of course, here's what he says. War across generational divide, page 160. People who are in their 60s, Paul, that's us, are called the baby boom generation. The values common to the baby boomer generation are synonymous with the paradigm shift in society beginning with the 1960s.
Yes.
That policy change, now this is the deeper part that most boomers won't realize. That policy change is deindustrialization of America. Deindustrialization society is a no future society because any self-respecting nation can only be truly independent if it can provide welfare for its citizens. So no growth, deindustrialization, in other words, let's take down America. How were the people who run the world able to impose this deindustrialization on society? Think about the profile of the American population. The generation with the strongest set of moral values in American history is the generation that fought World War II. Okay, that's
right.
That's an assertion. I don't know if it's true. But anyway, he said that they were born before the advent of TV. They were the hardest generation to brainwash. Their children, the baby boomers, became the targets of the brainwashers. In fact, with the advent of television, the baby boomers have spent their entire lives being brainwashed. That's us.
Yeah.
Think back... Goal of the brainwashers, to make each succeeding generation more infantile, more animal-like, more amoral, thus easier to control. So what we have here is cultural warfare being imposed on the United States. Here's what he says on page 107, creating the counterculture. The undeclared cultural war against America's youth began in earnest in 1967. That's the year I graduated from high school.
Uh-huh.
When Tavistock began using open-air rock concerts to attract over 4 million young people to the so-called festivals. Unbeknownst, the youth became the victims of planned, wide-scale drug experimentation. Hallucinogenic drugs such as, now here we got some hellacious, long chemical words, chemical formulas, dimethoxyphenylethylamine. Now, I could probably say it better if I try it again, but it's STP.
Yeah.
And then fencyclidine, PCP, dextromethorphan, methylenex dioxymethamphetamine, MDA, DMT, and the Beatles promoted LSD. And micro blue dot LSD 25 were freely distributed at these concerts. Before long, over 50 million of these attendees between the ages of 10 and 25 years old returned home to become the messengers and the promoters of the new drug culture, or what came to be called the New Age. Well, okay, what is this New Age? What's so new about the New Age? What makes the, so what is it that makes an open conspiracy open? Of course, open conspiracy, H.G. Wells, the British side of all of this, Aldous Huxley, H.G. Wells, it's all in their books and in their speeches. It was H.G. Wells who introduced Huxley, Aldous Huxley, to Satanist Aleister Crowley. Crowley was a poster child of the occult, British Cambridge graduate, mountain climber, all around MI6,
right.
MI6 spy, and a sorcerer of the very highest magnitude, member of the Golden Dawn, and supposedly he wrote a book about this channeled by a demon spirit, and the whole of the laws, do what thou wilt, well, of course, that's yeah. Aleister Crowley. And in the 60s, that became do your own thing.
Yeah.
So Crowley was a poster child of the occult that developed in Britain from the 1860s under the influence of Edward Bulwer-Lytton, the colonial minister under Lord Palmerston during the Second Opium War, in which, of course, the British East India Company with their friends in America were successful in getting the aristocracy of China hooked on opium, and then they could loot the country.
Yeah.
So you could start to see the same thing happening then to America in right. the 60s. Let's get these people so high and
right.
oblivious that we can just take everything they have.
That's exactly right. That's the pattern.
That's the pattern. So anyway, Crowley, William Butler Yeats, also one of these guys from Britain, you know. The trouble is we studied all these guys in college. They uh-huh. were given up to us
yes.
as the people that knew.
Uh-huh.
So much of this, you know, it was a complete system. They would give you the LSD at the concert. They'd give you the LSD on the street. You go to college, you study these same, you know, perverts.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
It's really quite a system here. William Butler Yeats, poet and Nobel Prize winner, and several other Bulwer-Lytton proteges, such as the satanic Isis Urania Temple of Hermetic Students of the Golden Dawn. Okay, that's Crowley.
Uh-huh.
This Isis cult was organized around the 1877 manuscript Isis Unveiled by Madame Helena Blavatsky of Russia, in which the Russian occultist called for the British aristocracy to organize itself into an Isis priesthood. And then Crichton Zoikas explains that among the other initiates in the Children of the Sun were T.S. Eliot, W.H. Auden, and again, these are the people we would have read in college, Sir Oswald Mosley and D.H. Lawrence, Huxley's homosexual lover. The Brave New World of Aldous Huxley centers on the scientific methodology for keeping all populations outside the elite minority into a permanently autistic-like condition, actually in love with their servitude.
Yeah.
Huxley pronounced, now we see the deeper reason behind the sex, drugs, and rock and roll.
That's right.
That was imposed. And here's what Huxley said in a speech in 1962, I believe, in Berkeley. There will be in the next generation or so a pharmacological method of making people yeah. love their servitude and producing dictatorship without tears, so to speak, producing a kind of painless concentration camp for entire societies so that people will, in fact, have their liberties taken away from them, which, of course, has happened and is happening now, but will rather enjoy it because they will be distracted from any desire to rebel by propaganda or brainwashing enhanced by pharmacological methods. And this yep. seems to be the final revolution. To Wells' way of thinking, this wasn't a conspiracy, but rather a one-world brain functioning as a police of the mind or a concentration camp of the mind. So we start to see then that music has been a tool of this elite group. Now let's go back to the Frankfurt School briefly here, and I'll get a quote from one of the leading Frankfurt School members, in his 1948 work on, quote, the philosophy of modern music, Frankfurt School leader Theodor Adorno argued that the purpose of modern music is to literally drive the listener insane. Okay, so there you have it. In his own words, there's the Theodor Adorno, who is thought to have had much to do with the music of the Beatles, even.
That's what I look for when I'm going to a music store. What can I buy here that'll drive me insane? Because that's the purpose of this thing.
Well, yeah, and of course, then he says, this is a commentator on Adorno. He justified this by asserting that modern society was a hotbed of evil, authoritarianism, and potential fascism, and that only by first destroying civilization through the spread of all forms of cultural pessimism and perversity could liberation occur. On the role of modern music, Adorno wrote, "It is not that schizophrenia is directly expressed therein, but the music imprints upon itself an attitude similar to that of the mentally ill."
Yeah.
So it mimics schizophrenia.
Yeah.
And of course, this is what Gregory Bateson was all about with the AC conferences, is how to induce schizophrenia or symptoms that mimic schizophrenia. In other words, the ruling elite is trying to take down the middle and lower class and subjugate them, just like the book 1984 that George Orwell penned in 1948. So here, going back to Adorno's writing, the individual brings about his own disintegration. He imagines the fulfillment of the promise through magic, but nonetheless within the realm of immediate actuality. Its concern is to dominate schizophrenic traits through the aesthetic consciousness. In so doing, it would hope to vindicate insanity as true health. Necrophilia, he added, or love of the dead, is the ultimate expression of true health in this sick society. Well, I'll pause. I'm sure you have something to say, Paul. This is the Frankfurt School. This is their goal. The authoritarian personality was something they researched a lot in order to try to bring down white Christian males that seemed to be the fundamental, and the family seemed to be the two fundamental power block, the underlying structures of American society. So the goal was, okay, how are we going to destroy American society? One way to do it is to take down the white male. Mm-hmm. Another way to do it is take down Christianity. And we think that these strategies will help us do it. And of course, the Frankfurt School gave us what has morphed into political correctness.
Right.
And it's this tyranny that our generation, this baby boomer generation, is imposing a tyranny of tolerance. In other words, we have to have multiculturalism. We have to import all these people from all over the world and, you know, pay for them as refugees. And the goal is, you know, a lot of nice Americans think that's great, you know, because we're nice people. But I mean, how many people can be supported in America before the whole thing just falls apart? We all have all these different cultures with all these different languages. There's no more cultural cohesion. There's no more There's no more there. There's no more America there. There's no more commitment to the Bill of Rights. There's no more commitment to the Constitution. There's no more commitment to scientific progress. They saw that as an impediment. They had a whole culture in the 40s and 50s committed to scientific progress and believing in Jesus and God.
And morals. Right.
And moral. This was a tough nut. And so the music then has been one of a whole series of strategies to destroy the United States so that it will not be able to continue as a force in the world. This group is fairly utopian. They envision something else, a different kind of utopia. And, of course, they are the ones who gave us what we call critical theory.
Yes.
At universities And this is also called you deconstruct the Derrida and the Foucault,
right.
The philosophy and the English professors would deconstruct every single document to the point where it no longer means what you thought it did.
Yeah.
Pretty soon it no longer means anything, and you're into this nihilistic world of, and these were my colleagues at the university. And so my 30 years at university very much dovetails with the conclusions of a guy like Daniel Estulin.
Yeah.
We have been subverted. We have been taken down by these movements, feminism to subvert the role of the white male. You know, now the white male is the oppressor.
Right.
And that was 20, 30 years. And then, of course, environmentalism. Mm. Now they become the exploited nigger. And,
right.
You know, humans are just another animal.
Yep.
They're not made in the image of God anymore. They're just another animal. And if there's too many humans, well, we better start cleansing
right.
the earth. Just like the New Agers say, we have to cleanse the earth of all these lower awareness humans. And then, of course, the multiculturalism and the political correctness. All these things are a form of propaganda. Never debated. I mean,
right.
you don't get to debate whether this is, you know, there's anything to this, whether there's any, you know, whether it's beneficial for the culture. You have to play by those rules or you can't, you know, you can't be a professor.
Right.
So anyway, a lot of this coming from the Frankfurt School, it's a deliberate attempt to take down America, and I think they have succeeded
sure.
dramatically. I'll pause there.
Well, especially, that's right. Especially if you see interviews with or films of or videos of kids objecting to free speech. And I mean, that's critical theory on steroids. Critical theory to me is criticize everything. Whatever structural, whatever's in society, criticize it until people can see problems with it. I think modern third wave feminism really does that. Everything's wrong. Even men. I mean, 50, well, I guess we're not 50%, but a lot of the culture are men, and we have a problem because something's wrong with men, you know? So, yeah, I see that happening. I want to go back to the 50s and 60s. But first of all, I want to go back to, I'm rocking. I have to stay close to, but I don't have a mic like yours. So, anyway, it seems to me that most of the classical music, including this church music, was generally probably created by the aristocratic class. And the music that was used by the lower class was simply minstrel music, where the minstrel would come around and give news, and I would imagine that the upper class could pretty much influence what kind of news got out, what kind of news didn't get out, and they could probably kind of control that. So I guess starting the 20th century, it became kind of a music. There became money in music, you know, with Scott Joplin and that whole genre, and then they created for some reason jazz, and jazz as related to sex, jazz, jizz. I mean, it's a. I know they considered it kind of a bastardization of music. I love it. I think that it's the most incredible innovation in music ever, the fact that someone could just start playing and, I mean, express themselves. And then we got to rock and roll. But I wanted to end up in the 50s because we started talking about probably our parents' generation was the last moral generation. And I remember last night or the night before, we watched a video on YouTube called Mike Hammer, My Gun Is Fast. It's a 1953 movie, and it's not long, and it's real simple. Back in the 50s, there were good guys and bad guys, and the good guy epitomized all the good of a good guy. I mean, this guy was an ex-veteran from World War II, and of course, that was the good war, the one that the Americans won, and we were the good guys. And Mike Hammer, he has women after him, but of course, he's not sexual with them. He's a moral guy, and he wants to do the right thing. Actually, one of the women that come on to him in this movie, he has to arrest because she's, even though she could have assured him wealth and, you know, a good life, he didn't like it. But then you move forward 10 years to 65, or 64 even, and you have James Bond. Now, James Bond's morality is different by this time. James Bond he's out for, it's not like little street crime and prostitutes and that kind of thing. He's international in focus. And his morality is one that's in line with the morality that they wanted to give us in the 60s and certainly did through the music and Woodstock and all that. And I would suggest if we would look at heroes as they go through these 10 years, we could see how Tavistock and Adorno and the Frankfurt School has gradually taken away our morals with movies and music. I think would be that would be their biggest, because even in the schools, I'm not sure the stuff in the schools didn't start until the 70s, I guess. What do you think, Eric?
But this book that we have been talking about a little bit, that Dr. John Coleman wrote, he was MI6, British spy, and also PhD, uh-huh. I think in political science. The name of the book, Tavistock Institute of Human Relations, subtitle is Shaping the Moral, Spiritual, Cultural, Political, and Economic Decline United States of America. That's the subtitle.
Right.
And of course, this whole goal harkens back to the will of Cecil Rhodes in the late 1800s, late 19th century, who envisioned bringing America back under colonial status to Britain, back to under the control of the British, and of course then the British Roundtable and the Milner Group in the early mm-hmm. part of the 20th century. So there's always been this very, very fascinating relationship between America and Britain. They trained our CIA. Our CIA trained the Mossad. And the German Nazi SS got incorporated into our CIA and
right.
has been very active post-World War II, as in America with NASA and with the mind control operations that are top secret, etc. So we have at the highest levels these intelligence operations that I think do not serve the people of the
country so too.
In which they live. They serve the power structure, which is international and financial. Yeah, but this idea of taking America down, it is the superpower, but it's now going to be destroyed from within. And, of course, now it is being destroyed from within.
Right.
And we need to understand that this is not just fate. This has been
right.
Scripted. And we can point out these institutions. And along the way, we can see that there's a political objective. But there's also this spiritual component. Now,
right.
Elvis Presley, apparently, going back to the 50s, you know, the greatest superstar of rock and roll and the guy that really kind of brought it in, he had a handler named Colonel Parker.
Mm-hmm.
But if you go on to this video that I've been telling you about, it's called They Sold Their Souls for Rock and Roll, it's quite clear that Elvis did that. And that his acting like a Christian was very much of a veneer that he used. He had, you know, he had everything. He, you know, he obviously had made that deal with the devil, and he actually had powers that apparently resulted from that deal. That I have to tell
right.
this one anecdote that I think one of his he had people that worked with him, you know, kind of an entourage that knew him for his whole career. And apparently the story was they were driving along somewhere in Tennessee or Mississippi or somewhere, and just totally pouring rain, and they could hardly see where they were going in the car. And Elvis said, okay, that's enough of this. I can take care of this. And they opened the sunroof, and of course the water was pouring in. And then he did some mumbo jumbo into the sky. And according to the guy next to him, he said, right. I swear, you know, what happened was this guy opened up and the sun came streaming right down onto the road. Well, if you believe that story, it would appear that Elvis had some juju, some power there. So, you know, we're trying to understand this whole thing. Obviously, those stars that do, you know, kind of call on these fallen angels or Satan, this is called theurgy, summoning spirits. Apparently, the spirits are there to be summoned.
Right.
And they do have some power to bestow. And apparently, Elvis had quite a bit of it, at least for a while. So there's a political thing going on, and there's a spiritual thing going on, and it's very difficult to distinguish one from the other, because I think they're operating together.
Yes.
And I, you know, the guys in the white suits in Washington D.C. or the professors at the university seem to be operating mostly on the intellectual and political level, but then there is this other dimension that's operative, and this is what I think is so confusing to people, myself included, because I wouldn't have wanted to give any credence or credibility to these spiritual forces for most of my career, being a, you know, professor.
Me too.
I just wrote that stuff off. But apparently that there is that power to be tapped into. I think it's very sad when people make that choice to sell themselves to the devil.
Yes.
But then there are all these people that get born into it, into these Illuminati, satanic families. And I think that's even sadder because those people probably didn't have a choice.
You know, exactly.
They were pulled into it as a child in various rituals, which we're starting to understand. And of course, then this whole dynamic was very, very much incorporated into these top secret governmental programs with the Nazis in World War II. The marionette programming is satanic ritual abuse, and that came to America with the Nazis after World War II, thanks to the Operation Paperclip and other means of smuggling these criminals into this country. Alan Dulles has a lot to do with that. Maybe we can talk about Alan Dulles at some point. But then the MK Ultra program, the Bluebird, Artichoke, all these top secret mind control programs, experimenting with, okay, how do drugs affect people? Every kind of conceivable drug used as war weapons, experimented as war weapons, and then dumped on the kids of America in the 60s, you know, when the CIA was producing, had this contract with Eli Lilly to produce all these tabs of LSD, which they dumped, as we mentioned last week, at Woodstock and at Monterey at the festival. So you know what you see is this convergence of occultism, sex, drugs, rock and roll in the counterculture of the 60s, which we thought was some kind of organic response to the Vietnam War, which was, of course, very oppressive and seemed very unjust to a lot of us. Here it would seem, based on the work of David McGowan and others, that the counterculture was not organic, that in fact was controlled by these same people. Alan Dulles formed the CFR back in the 1921 with Colonel House and Woodrow Wilson and his brother John Foster Dulles and the Warburg brothers, the bankers of Germany. And the CFR, of course, is the American branch of the Royal Institute of International Affairs in England. And they answer, I think, to the power structure, not to the American citizens.
Absolutely.
And always have. And the CIA, likewise, always answered to the CFR and to the power structure. rather than to the people of America. Well, of course, this is a problem because the Constitution guarantees that government is set up to protect the rights and the property of its citizens. Right. So these guys have always been criminals in the strictest sense. The CFR and the CIA are criminal institutions because they violate and have always violated the American Constitution. And I just wrote an extended piece about Alan Dulles and his career. Unbelievable, the criminality of this one individual. He subverted for 50 years, he subverted every presidential administration he served under. These guys have always considered themselves above the law.
Right.
And then he became the first CIA head in 1953 and served till 1961, the longest running CIA. And he brought the Nazis in. He started the paperclip projects. The Vietnam War was started by the CIA under him, and all these coups and assassinations. So all this is not organic. It's coming from, you know, Tavistock. It's coming from the ruling elite. We have been, I think, you could say victimized by it. We've certainly been... There's a Hegelian principle there. You got the war in Vietnam over here, and then when there is an organic anti-war movement in the colleges of America, which was intelligent and well-based, then the same forces that created the war, the intelligence people, you know, take their operations using their own children, oftentimes, or mind-controlled, like Jim Morrison and others, probably fractured personalities themselves, and they become our rock stars, and they usher us down this primrose path into Satanism, occultism, sex, drugs, and rock and roll. So it was a way then to, number one, neutralize the legitimate debate about the legitimacy of the war in Vietnam on the one hand, and it was a way to move all of America into this occult spiritism, which is coming from, I trace it back to a combination of the British elite, the royal family, and the Rothschild family, as being the principal founders and funders and ideological supporters. And bottom line, they're both Satanism. It's Satanism.
Right. Satanism.
I think it has many, many faces, but it is Satanism.
Yeah, I think when they always say follow the money, you'll be able to diagnose what happened. That's to a certain extent, but if you don't realize that it's a spiritual battle going on, then you miss a whole 50%. You miss the whole top level, because these guys do things not for money. The Rothschilds don't need money, but they're doing
half the world's wealth.
That's right. They're doing it for a really different reason. And to go back to what you were saying about organic, a lot of times I've spoken to other boomers and have wanted to explain to them about McGowan's findings and how Theodore Adorno and the Frankfurt School actually really created the Beatles and a lot of their lyrics and probably everything. So it's really hard to find something organic in the boomer experience. I mean, it's really when you go down through it. Well, what came up after kind of the awakening where we were all hippies and everything? Well, New Age, and they had given Christianity a face that time of a real severely, hardcore. Judgmental hellfire and brimstone thing that when put up against the sex, drugs, and rock and roll and we love everybody really didn't come off that, you know, they had disempowered the element of Christianity. So we all kind of flopped into this not organic New Age movement, which, you know, is an offshoot of Blavatsky and some of her revivification of some of the Eastern religions. So the boomer experience is really an interesting thing to look back on and study the different components, because you find that nothing's real. Everything was given to us. Everything was orchestrated. Even to the point where, before 65 came and McGowan's hippie movement was started, which was absolutely started, nothing organic about it. I mean, they were dressing the way hippies, or the way gypsies did. I mean, that we were really, really fitting a mold. But before that, for 10 years, they were kind of ripping off the teenagers from the rest of the world. We had a different kind of music. Paul Anka, Annette Funicello, and I mean, it's really sappy, schmaltzy kind of. There is some good rock and roll back there, but it's a loosening up your heart and putting you into this romantic culture that's certainly softened me up to be just put right into this plop Penny Lane, you know, Hey Jude kind of thing. It just softened me right up. Meanwhile, what I've been noticing is the adults were fed a different music. Their music was all about space age. They were considered jet setters. So it was bossa nova, cha-cha-cha, that kind of stuff. Really focused on spy music. So they had their focus on something different while they were seducing the lost boomer generation into this false reality that we just experienced. Do you think I'm close on that?
Oh, I think it's very, very perceptive. And when you contrast what our experience was, you know, which really just kind of kicked things off. I mean, the whole point, by the time you got to the middle, late 60s, was to have music that would offend the parents.
Yes.
So now you've got this cultural generation gap imposed by the popular music. Think of all the other generations of human beings in every culture in the past. The children would learn the music of the parents.
Uh-huh.
And there would be a continuity that goes from one generation to the next,
right?
Which you see really in Spanish music. You know, one of the reasons I love Mexican music and whatnot. It's the same from one generation to the next.
Oh, American music in the beginning of the 20th century, exactly the same thing. It's a continuity.
Yeah.
Jazz to swing to, you know.
Yeah, so, you know, there is a natural, you know, it does move, it does change. But what we had, as you say, that was imposed, that was contrived, that was given to us by very, very smart people.
Yeah.
Now we've started to name some of these people.
Right.
These people are and of course, they don't have our welfare at heart.
Yeah, absolutely.
In other words,
not.
The goal is to take down the society. The goal of these smart people is to destroy our culture, and
right.
That's why I read the title from Coleman's book. So, is there time to is America resilient enough? Are the people good enough? Are the people sane enough still to recoup, to kind of realize what has happened, and then find the jewels, the gems, the uplifting aspects of culture and music,
right,
that we can use to recover
recover.
We're in recovery.
We right.
have a whole nation in recovery, or that would actually be a good thing if we could recognize that we had been traumatized,
right,
by very clever people, and that a lot of the music that we're being fed is full of dark, evil spirits.
Right.
And we have to find a way to, I guess, exorcise those
right.
demons from our souls. And of course, you know, this is one of the aspects of Christianity. Jesus did cast out demons, and he did
right.
empower his disciples to do the same, and they did. And there are still, I think, some Christians in America who feel solid enough in their relationship with Jesus,
mm-hmm.
regardless of what church they go to,
right,
to take on that role. In other words, to take on that authority And in the Bible it says, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. And of course, he that is in the world in that case means Satan, because Satan is the ruler of this world or the prince of this world. So the idea that greater is he that is in you, if you are a Christian, that if you have made that decision, commitment, and reinforced it, it would be possible, and it is possible,
right,
for Christians doing this sort of thing and doing this kind of healing, even to the extent of perhaps some of the victims of MKUltra, mind control, which is a form of satanization. Another way I think you could look at this whole 60s thing and the whole modern trajectory of our culture is we are being and have been deliberately satanized.
Yes.
Which, of course, then you get what you said, we're in a spiritual war. And right. Satan wants souls, and so does God. And so in a sense, we're kind of like a wishbone. Each one of us is a wishbone. And,
right.
You know, one leg is being pulled this way and one leg is being pulled that way. And we all then have to kind of make our decision.
Yeah. I think that one thing that they did early on in our generation, and I think it was to our generation too, they took out Satan and demons. We're probably the only culture that doesn't have a tradition with demons. Demons have been a reality on mankind from one culture to another. They're demons. I mean, I had a friend, he's a couple years older than me, but he was born in Athens, Greece. And his mother used to do stuff with looking across bowls of water to strike out. It's whitewashed from our culture. So we don't have any reference when that happens, when MKUltra makes an altar in us that makes a space for a demon. What can we try? We treat it with Prozac or because we've lost our language. And the same with Satan. I mean, if you talk to a New Ager about that concept, it's very difficult because the concept isn't not there for them. So you kind of have to bring that culture back. So you can't deal with something you can't name. You can't deal with something you can't conceptualize. So I think one of the first things would be to kind of help us re-language what we lost back in the 50s and the 40s. Because my mother knew who Satan was. I mean, she...
Yeah.
You know?
Well, you know, it was Confucius who was asked one time, of course, of ancient China, was asked, we've got all these problems. You know, how should we approach it? How should we fix them? And he said, well, the first step would be to rehabilitate the language. And I think you are absolutely right. I meet younger people who they're fine people, I think, you know, but like you say, they don't have this mental structure anymore because they don't have the words, right. And they'll say something like, oh, it's all good.
Oh,
it's all good.
That's so tragic.
Well, yeah, because, you know, and that person is sincere. They're trying to explain reality, trying to understand reality, but they are crippled. With a loss of concepts and language. And of course, George Orwell talked about that, in his book 1984. That's what the ministry of, the Ministry of Truth did. They envisioned a society where, you know, they keep eliminating words.
Right.
Until eventually, you know, by 2050 or whatever, 2100, when the aristocracy finally has imposed its complete control over all everybody else who becomes their slave and servant. The slaves and servants only speak very, very rudimentary language. They become beasts again, really animals. And this, I think, is what the aristocracy has had in mind for us. You look at, the language of some of the, go to the Talmud, you know, there's the goyim. Goyim is the word for non-Jews, and it means cattle.
Cattle.
It means beast.
Right.
So then the perception of the people who study the Talmud, which is the rabbis, would be that everybody who is not a Jew is a beast, is subhuman, and therefore it's okay to rob, steal, kill.
Right.
Goyim. Well, that same concept, of course, gets used by other members of the aristocracy, like in Britain and whatnot. And Wilhelm Wundt, who was one of the great early psychologists or psychiatrists, or I guess you'd say psychologists from Germany, you know, he had this idea which caught on, which is that humans are really just kind of input-output machines.
Yeah.
We're just like animals. And then, of course, Pavlov over in Russia with Pavlov's dog. I mean, the whole basis of this modern psychiatry and psychology is that, you know, we're just stimulus response packages.
Right.
And if you do this, if you push this button, you'll get this response. The assumption is we're always trying to maximize our own benefit, self-interest, that we have no higher purpose.
Right.
We're just machines, really, that somehow got on the earth. And if these psychiatrists can figure out how to manipulate these machines, us,
right,
then they win, you know, and then, of course, that we serve them. So I think this is a very, very fundamental flaw in all of psychology nowadays. I mean, I think we are created in the image of God, myself.
Right,
I think
me too.
Human reason and human ability to create music and science and other forms, this is man's divine birthright.
I think so
and
too.
And these people are stripping us of that. They're intentionally. Obviously, when they set up a gigantic situation like Woodstock, you know, where how many people were out there rolling around in the mud for days. They couldn't escape at Woodstock in 1969. They were given copious amounts of drugs and alcohol,
right,
you know, the idea is to turn these individuals into beasts, you know.
That's the idea. Or machines, or combine us with a machine. And the only antidote for me is the awakening, realizing what's going on. And one of the things that holds us back is a lot of the New Age notions, but what the New Age notion that it's all good. Now, that just lies up with Satanism's expression, do what thou wilt should be the whole of the law. You really have to wake up to the fact that it's not all good. That if you look at something like the Hampstead cover-up, there's no way you could think of that being good for those young children and what's happening to them. And so you have to wake up to the dark side, I think. Anyway, that was my path anyway.
Yeah, could you explain that, Paul, the Hampstead cover-up, since I don't watch TV.
Well, it's not been on TV. Actually, myself and only two other researchers have taken the time to investigate it and constantly interview the people involved. There was a woman she had two beautiful young children, 8 and 9 years old, from a husband who had left earlier. He had been a problem husband in that he had been abusive with her, and there was a restraining order against him. So she had a new boyfriend who was just happened to be a really street smart guy who had done a lot of work with nutritional hemp. He's not a smoker. He doesn't. He's opposed to THC. He thinks it's bad. Well, anyway, the mother and the boyfriend and the two children go on a vacation. And during the vacation, the boyfriend, who's extremely street smart, notices that they're playing with the dog inappropriately. And so he asked them about it, and he noticed that they play with each other also. And so he got them to loosen up and give hours and hours of testimony to a policeman and to him about ritual sexual abuse and child murder in Hampstead, England, in the school. And the father would come there a couple times a week and have sex with them all in the school. And it was a ritual, that was a big ritual thing. Now, of course, the whole UK government panics over this because we've got kids. And if you watch the videos, they're somewhere on our website, you'll see that these kids are, I mean, you can only teach a kid to do so many things. And these kids were honest and upright, and they knew details, and they were reinforcing one another. I mean, it wasn't the type of thing that you can train a kid to do. I have 2 degrees in education and one in psychology, and I know that you can't do this. So we followed the mother, and we got interviewed. But of course, the judge, even though there were signs of abuse, these kids drew tattoos that the abusers had on their bodies. There was no investigation done. Totally covered up by, the Child Protection Services, the legal services. I mean, and now they've turned the tables. I'm about to do a podcast on that this week. They turned the tables on these kids, and they're accusing the mother and the boyfriend of being the ones that are doing the child abuse. We're doing the child abuse, which is absolutely totally impossible. And I'll break that down when I do that podcast. But when you get nose to nose with that type of abuse, or you know people whose parents have been given polio so that they could be manipulated, you know that there's an evil force. And if you want to call it the devil or Lucifer or whatever you want to call it, I think it's a good term because, you know, we have something to talk about. But you can't be it's all good because first of all, it's just not true. It's an assault against reality, not to mention assault against morality. So every time I hear that it's all good or don't focus on the negative, da da da, these new age concepts, they're the things that keep us from examining what's going on. You see, in order to wake up, you really have to examine what you've been through. Like, I've been through a contrived education system, the music I was given was contrived, the belief systems I was given was contrived, and it took me the last 15 years to try, what's Paul, you know? What do you see when you turn out the lights, you know? It's mine, I don't know what it is. I don't know what was given to me by Adorno, what was given to me by the Frankfurt School. You have to pull yourself out of it. And one of the things that helps is conceptualizing evil, knowing that there is a real, it's not relative reality. And anyway, so I think that's a good way to start digging out. Get our language back and start figuring out what's real.
Okay. Well, you know, of course, you mentioned that Hampstead cover-up. I have seen a little bit about that on YouTube, so I know what you're talking about now. Of course, that relates to the Franklin cover-up and the Dutroux thing and in Belgium. And you look deeply, and you listen to the interviews of Kay Griggs, a lady, I think a very honorable lady back in Virginia, who's very smart and was married to an officer in the, I think, Marines, but I'm not sure. Who was one of these mind-controlled assassins. And you start to realize that, you know, at the higher levels, the you could call it not just the aristocracy, you could call it the pathocracy or the pedophocracy.
Yeah.
There is an awful lot of homosexuality and pedophilia going on, an awful lot. In fact, the Franklin cover-up, I think, extended to protect George H.W. Bush and his White House group back in the late 80s.
Yeah.
This would appear to be a component of Satanism, mm-hmm. which, of course, they are now foisting on society. They're with the LGBT thing. They're
right.
trying to move America into their satanic practices so that they are legal. Of course, we already have same-sex marriage now approved at the highest
right.
So America's fundamentally being engineered, being changed. And again, fascism is top-down revolution. These revolutions are coming from the top, from the very, very, very sick elite the Illuminati elite that, and we recognize that. So I personally think, you know, in the Bible they name names, you know.
Right.
I think we're at the point where we can say, okay, this so-and-so, at least we can give a couple sheets of names that are certainly behind 911.
Right.
We they're obviously more of a supporting cast elsewhere, but we can start to put together lists of the criminals, the real criminals, not Osama bin Laden, who's right. the patsy. Likewise with the JFK assassination.
Exactly.
We can do that now. The information is out there. These criminals are unpunished. They have not been held accountable for their crimes, which of course are to traumatize the American people so that they can commit more crimes, so that we will dissociate and freak out and not hold them responsible for these crimes. I can tell a little story. I don't know if it's appropriate, but I grew up in the D.C. area, and I was 13 or maybe 14 when Kennedy was assassinated on November 22nd, 1963. And, you know, that was a tremendously traumatic experience for the entire nation. Now we know that Tavistock had done many years worth of research on trauma-based mind control and how it can be imposed on an individual and how those same principles can then be applied to the society at large. So Tavistock would be, or at least the tools of Tavistock, from what I gather, the CIA and the Mossad were involved in that, as well as in 911, the planning and execution. And it might have been Ben-Gurion in Israel who really, called for the hit. But there were all these factors going on, and it was trauma-based mind control for the nation, and it worked. A lot of people think that that was the end of America's optimism and idealism and innocence, and that we have been going downhill ever since. And then Kennedy might have been the last independent president who was actually trying to run the country. He didn't realize that the CIA was supposed to run the country.
Right.
And he had so many disagreements with the CIA, and of course he fired Allen Dulles after the Bay of Pigs. And you could say, well, Allen Dulles fired John F. Kennedy a couple years later he was going to the farm, which was an extra bunker that the CIA used as a control center outside of D.C. He was there on the weekend of the Kennedy assassination.
Dulles?
Dulles was, just like Cheney was, you know, at the control room during 911. So these guys are criminals.
Right.
I mean, murder's a crime, right?
Right.
Speaking of the language, I've heard the phrase, the murder meme, the murder meme. No, a meme, of course, means a theme or, you know, murder is not a meme. Murder is a crime.
Right.
And this is how our language has been and is being corrupted and co-opted. Murder is not a meme. Murder is a crime. It's one of the things you're not supposed to do in the Ten Commandments. You know, so let's go back to that. Let's hold on to that. You know?
That's right.
I think we're at the point where we can name names, which means, of course, that the ruling elite can, they can pull the plug with a financial crisis or a nuclear explosion, or, Jade Helm could go live.
Right.
We could have civil war here next week, this evening, you know, for that matter, if Obama wants to or somebody else.
Yeah.
So we're in a precarious position, but we are starting to wake up. And I think that's the good news, you know, that this information is out there. It's documented. You're not making this stuff up. I'm not making this stuff up. I've got a whole library of books that talk about this sort of thing.
Right. And I will point to the fact that, oh, man, we've got 160 years, 130 years between us of watching this stuff. And, there's a lot to be said for an examined life. Oscar Wilde said that an unexamined life isn't worth living. And I think that's really true, and especially true nowadays. as the people are waking up, and they are waking up, honestly, the response to our podcasts and what we've been doing, it's just a little stuff that we do. We're not big. But the response is they understand, they get it. And we've been watching YouTube videos in the evening. You can see our blog is pineconeutopia.wordpress.com. And we put on a couple every day. And these incredible young researchers will sit and they'll look at something that's issued by the government. And they'll see the symbology. They'll put the symbology together. And they'll link it to another thing that's happening in the UK and another thing that's happening. And they'll present it to you. And it's just, it's like I've been struggling with this all my life, looking and trying to find. Now there's so many people on board, and we're all throwing this back to one another. Like all the research that you've done in your 65 years, and all the research that I've done, you know, we're throwing it out there. Here it is. You don't have to live this for yourself. Believe us when we tell you that the rock and roll movement was an orchestrated Tavistock. I mean, it was well done. The music by the Beatles was probably written by, if not just simply inspired by, Theodor Adorno, who was a monster. He was thrown out of Germany for child molesting or something. I mean, these guys are horrible monsters, and they've got us to this point, but now we're waking up, see? And we're waking up with all these other people, and we're seeing what's going on. And I think that's what we're trying to do here. We're trying to explain how music influences you, how you have to be careful. But also, realize what you're doing. Realize what you're listening to. Realize what's around you, because that's the awakening. And the awakening, I think, it led me to God so far. And Eric's the same way. I think it will for a lot of people. So I'm hoping that happens, and I'm hoping we get enough information out, especially about this music thing that Eric knows so much about, how this is affecting us.
Yeah, the human mind has no firewall, is what the right. Computer people say. And, you know, what goes in, there's no filters, especially for little kids, of course.
Oh, yeah.
And so, therefore, we have a tremendous responsibility to try to filter. Of course, censorship is, we don't like that. Nobody likes censorship. Of course, it depends on who's doing it.
Right.
But yeah, we need to be very careful, I think, realizing that there can be spiritual implications to certain kinds of music that your child is, or your teenager is listening to. Obviously, we saw that with, you know, was it Klebold and the Harris, the guys that did the Columbine. These guys were Satanists, and they listened to that kind of music.
Right.
And they wrote about killing people, and they especially wanted to target Christians. And they did target Christians. And so these young men were very much destroyed, I would say. Obviously, if you believe in that kind of a spiritual universe, what they did would warrant them a place deep down in hell. And so they destroyed themselves as well as their classmates, a number of them, and going after Christians in particular. Now, you know, perhaps the parents were doing something else. But,
who knows?
But, you know, obviously the parents need to take a much more proactive stance on what are the inputs to their children. You know,
right.
And I know the state has moved into that arena and has taken children away from their parents, you know, as you see with the Hempstead case and many, many others. The state wants to be the parent.
Right.
And of course, if you go back to the original Illuminati mandate of 1776, put together by Adam Weishaupt for the Rothschilds and the Frankist elders of Zion, who apparently were funding this thing, the goal was to remove and destroy all institutions that would stand in the way of complete global control, those being all monarchies, the nation state, religion, the family, private property. These
right.
have been the targets ever since that 1776 meeting, and this is well documented, and the Illuminati took over the top degrees of Freemasonry because it was already a very powerful secret society. And then, of course, the French Revolution, and then the American Revolution happened right then, and then the Russian Revolution, always trying to overturn the given order, God's order,
right,
to move in the satanic New World Order behind the New Age. That's one of its recent phases. But this goes back to the Illuminati documents, which are well known. Karl Marx, the Satanist, expressed it slightly differently, but same goals, mm-hmm. To get communism.
Right.
And then we see it in the same goals and the protocols of the learned elders of Zion. And we see it, expressed in the rock music. This is Satan's plan. And
right.
It is well advanced. Perhaps this train cannot be stopped. Perhaps if you buy the Book of Revelations, we're headed really quite
right.
closely to the last days here. But on an individual level, people can wake up. People can have an effect on the people around them by their own spiritual realizations and commitments. So in a way, I think you and I are, we're trying to provide perspective and information. We're also saying, hey, there's something really big at stake here.
Right.
It's probably your soul and the soul of the people
right.
around you, for starters, And then exactly what happens to the whole thing, whether we, whether we go right into the end times, next week or in 50 years or 100 years or 1,000 years, we don't know that.
Right.
But we do know that there's some big spiritual consequences to our life choices now, our decisions, and that we can affect things for the good still.
Right. Life choices has really been coming on strong for me lately. Yeah, your life choices are really the critical piece in the awakening, because I think you get to a point where you've seen so much, and there's been so much shattering of what this sacred cow, that sacred cow. I was taught that in school. Oh, it's not true anymore. Oh, I love that. I love the Beatles, and I do love the Beatles, and I still listen to them. But I know I have to be wary. I have to know what the lyrics say. I mean, you have to be cautious. But and I think that's where we are now. We're into the point where I think it's beyond belief. I think you're in a point where you know what's right, and when you get up in the morning, you do what's right, and you don't do what's wrong. And it sweetens the pot for everybody. It shows the way for other people. Plus, it helps them learn, right from wrong. It's easy to know right from wrong if you're not in a world of deceivers. But in a world where you're bombarded with nothing but deception, you really have to do a lot of thinking and a lot of investigating to know right from wrong. And I think that's where we are. And this is the important time. And I think the more we do the right thing, the more people will see what's going on, and maybe we can make it easier. I always think about the tribulation. Now, I'm new at this faith, but thinking about the tribulation, does it have to be number 10 on tribulation, or could we jack it down to about a 5? Could we, by working together and helping one another and helping wake people up and helping spread food, I don't know what you do, but do you think you could make it? Could you improve it? You know what I mean, Eric?
Yeah, well, the Greek philosophers and the Catholic Church talked about the three transcendentals of truth, beauty, and goodness.
Uh-huh.
And I think, you talk about the importance of making your choices. Well, I think, that's a pretty good target. Truth,
right.
Beauty and goodness,
Right.
And as you mentioned, really the only way probably that we really can influence people is by our example.
Yeah.
That this is the most powerful witness that we have is our life choices, our behavior. Now, that said, you know, as I said last time, I'm a sinner, you know, so.
Oh, me too. Me too.
We do make mistakes, and the great thing about God and Jesus is that there is forgiveness to a sinner who repents and tries to. Metanoia is the term for turning around, to recalibrating with the way the universe really is. Mm-hmm. In other words, God's way more powerful than Satan. Satan has certain number of days and a certain limited power, but God and Jesus are supreme, omnipotent, and we really have to feel very sorry for, not in a pity sense, but have to have some compassion for those who've made this very, very erroneous choice, which is, you know, selling your soul at the crossroads, like,
right.
You know, Robert Johnson or Eric Clapton or Bob Dylan seem to
right.
say they've done. That's not a good choice. That's a mistake. That's a bad mistake personally,
right.
And it affects others. So I think with that, armed with that kind of realization, with that knowledge, with that conviction, we can talk about these things with others and say, hey, let's get on board, you know,
right.
And let's try to make this thing as right as we can, you know. Truth, goodness, and beauty is a good place to start, cultivating
yeah.
those things. And I like to think that we are cultivating truth as we speak, and that I am trying to cultivate beauty in my music, and that's what music is
right.
about. Not tearing people down to the lowest form of hell, you know.
Well, most of the music is centered around sex, and you know that all the Satan is all about sex cults. I mean, the Freemasons are the sex cult, the Jesuits are a sex cult. They're all sex cults, so they're going to want to enroll us in there with the music, and I think they've done a pretty good job. I mean, that's, they've got women tweaking all over the twerking. That's twerking. What's tweaking? I don't know what tweaking. Well, anyway, so I think that's happening. I think staying away from the sexual nature of music might be a good idea. What kind of music are you doing now?
Well, good question. You know, I've made something like 20 CDs over the duration, because I've always loved music. I made a full-length movie. I've got about 9 CDs that I've made, which are instrumentals that I've written. And I seem to really enjoy that. I've got 3 instrumental piano, all original CDs, 3 on guitar, and I'm working on my second one on banjo now. And I'm moving towards gospel,
cool.
More and more bluegrass gospel. I think that between what I would consider beautiful instrumentals and the message that you get in gospel singing, that this is kind of what I want to put out.
Right.
When you're young, of course, you just copy whatever is out there. You know, so if, you know, Beatles are singing, why don't we do it in the road? You know,
right.
Maybe you'll just, you know, get drunk and say, why don't we do it in the road?
I'll cover it, yeah.
Or Lay, Lady, Lay, you know, these are the songs that I grew up with too. And believe me, I learned them and I sang them.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it is out there in the in the kind of the etheric subconscious realm of the whole culture, thanks to these rock stars. But there wasn't much discernment, was there, in our generation? I mean, if you're at a party and you
right.
know somebody's passing around a bottle of wine or whatever, you know, your discernment drops off. You know,
yeah, as sure.
you buy more. And yeah, the sex cult thing is, you know, sex is a wonderful gift from God. We're not against sex,
right?
But we are against. We are against the kind of sex, or we've learned that free sex is an oxymoron. There is no such thing as free sex, because there are consequences, and people get hurt, and it can be destructive. And now the ultimate, of course, is these satanic rituals, you know, where they have sex on the altar with whatever, with the god. And it goes right back to the goddess cults of you know, the ancient days.
Right.
And I guess people would get loaded and go and have, you know, the priestesses would be the sex gods, the goddesses and whatnot. And it actually sounds pretty good at first, you know, from a guy's point of view, to go down to the temple and, you know. But then this gets out of hand. It gets into witchcraft. It gets into orgies in the woods. It gets into human sacrifice. It gets into real craziness, and it gets into the real dark stuff. It's a portal to the real dark stuff. So you take something beautiful like sex and turn it into a portal to the real dark stuff. You take something that should be beautiful like music and you turn it into a portal into the dark stuff.
Right.
Well, Satan knows that these things can be exploited for these purposes. And so this is what we've seen in our experience. So we have seen these things that we all like, music and sex, to become very, very destructive.
Yeah, I think that we're in a funny catbird seat to comment on that, because we've been through it. We've really been through it, and there's nobody that's more guilty of that than me. With sex, when you start engaging in sex, especially if it's not... let me just jump out and say, based on the concept of either procreation or some type of love appreciation, I mean, with that really in your mind, you get on what they call a hedonistic treadmill, where what turned you on yesterday might not turn you on today. You need a little bit more of the jazz. You did a little bit more of the, you need a little bit more of the taboo, and then you move in. And it gets you into places where, unless you're a really strong individual, it's really hard to keep from going deeper and deeper and deeper. So just as a voice of experience, you've got to really realize that sex is a gift from God, and it's a sacred thing, and you can help make a divine creation with this act. I mean, talk about a amazing thing. You can make a creation with this. You can help God make another human being. I consider it a divine creation with this act. And it's not just a way to sell Pepsi or a way to sell beer or a way to fill up an afternoon, or you know, it's an important piece of your life. And I would just advise people that are going through this aspect to realize it's a powerful thing. And it's like music. If you don't care what you're saying and you don't care what you're expressing, I guess you can get in deep trouble with it. But if you hold it sacred and you pay it the same respect that you would pay this godly act with the same respect that you'd address God, I think it'll help you get through that. And I hate to give advice like that, but I've got 71 years here, Eric, and I've done it all, you know.
Please, just tell it like it is. I mean, young people, presumably, hopefully, will listen to your words, and, you know, that's been the pattern of human existence from the beginning. The young people need to listen to old people with some experience. And, of course, that was part of the problem with the, you know, the separation of the generations. Then there was no more communication. And then the younger generation can just go off and make all the mistakes in the world, thinking that they're discovering something wonderful.
And it's shiny, and it's beautiful, and it smells great, and it's all encompassing, and it takes you out of your little worries and your little world for a little while, but it doesn't make it go away, and it doesn't make it any better, and you get yourself locked into this deeper and deeper darkness that at some point you have to pull yourself out of. So I don't know.
Well, of course, you know, the country now, our America, is being pushed into the BLGT movement. And, you know, with this tyranny of tolerance that we have with politically correctness, if you were to be at a university and you know, speak out against that,
yeah,
you would be vilified. You would be perhaps yeah. hounded out. You know, because this is one of the really sacred planks of, I would say, the Illuminati takeover yeah. of America. And now this is a subject, you know, that I shouldn't speak about, you know, because it's not politically correct. But I will say what I've learned, I think, through all my research, that the act I'll just get them mixed up, you know, if Sodom and Gomorrah, it's in the Bible, you know, yeah. the act of sodomy can, from what I read, allow demon spirits in to the individual, perhaps being sodomized, I'm not sure. This is perhaps why, you know, the Skull and Bones, when they initiate their young initiates at Yale every year, 15 guys are tapped. They do these weird, you know, born again in the coffin, they roll around in the mud.
Right.
Well, they are encouraged. They are encouraged to sodomize each other, I believe. If not in that context, in others. And again, this is, you know, this is not politically correct to say this nowadays, but what they want to do, of course, is to do that. And they eventually want to do it with boys and girls. The homosexual community wants your kids. They want boys. They're not content with other males,
right?
From what I understand. And I've, you know, done a little reading and listening on this, and I think it has to be stopped. I think that Christian values need to come back to America, or else America probably will go the way of Sodom and Gomorrah. It will be destroyed. You could look at it from, you know, it's going to be destroyed by the Frankfurt School or Tavistock or God or whatever. In other words, there's a price to be paid for the immorality involved with BLGT.
Right.
You know, people in my own family would very much disagree with me on this. But I am pretty firm on it in my sense that there is a spiritual component to sex. And when we get into the area of the BLGT, we're really giving the finger to the Creator.
Yeah.
We're just it's kind of an in your face degradation of his creation and the rules that came with the creation.
Right.
I don't want to belabor that, but if you have something you want to add to that.
Yeah,
I
mean, let me
it's
add
not
this.
A comfortable thing. It's not a comfortable thing to talk about.
Well, I think we need to talk about it. It's the same as talking about the devil, the same as talking about, you need to talk about what they're doing. I did some research, and tomorrow I'm going to do a little podcast on this bizarre bathroom thing we have going in the United States. But I was looking up Common Core. You know what Common Core is? Common Core is the plan, the federal plan, and it's got a
UN.
Yeah.
It's got a
sexual component, and it's performance based. It's like management by objectives. You never want to put your education system in management by objectives, because if you've been in business, you know that what they do with objectives is they'll narrow the focus of the performer down, and it ruins everything else you're going to learn. It ruins everything because you're into that objective. Well, anyway, these performance objectives, and one of the ones that I saw, I was just perusing through this. Of course, you know, when you start in Common Core and you're a child, you have to pick your sex. And it's a lot more than two. Even though scientifically, biologically, there are only two. It's two. I saw this one illustration. It's a fifth grade lesson. And it's about inserting a female condom into the anus. And the picture that the illustration that they have in the textbook of is of a male. So we're starting to this institutionalization of anal sex, which I think really, I think it keeps your kundalini in a real low place, especially if it's done before 6 or 7 years old. I think it really, it damages your ability, your spirit's ability to move freely in the body, I think. Aleister Crowley thought it was, well, he thought that the anus was a stargate because it gave visions of, you know, he. So anyway, so if you don't know anything about Common Core and you have children in the public school, they're going to be taught this, and it's performance-based. So I would imagine that at some point, the teacher would have to check the performance of these children in preparing, you know, it's just gone way off the deep end is what I'm saying, I guess.
Yeah, wow. Yeah, of course, Common Core is right out of the United Nations. And then we get back to our friend Marie Strong and, you know, Robert Mueller and all those guys. Yeah, they are also New Age advocates, and which is just, you know, just a different approach to Satanism.
Just another.
I'm afraid. So we come back down again to Christian values of morality versus this. I mean, Aleister Crowley's view that, you know, the anus is the gateway to the stars. I mean, that would be, I suppose, a Satanist worldview. And a Christian worldview would be that the demon spirits get in.
Yeah.
During that kind of sex. I've become a Christian because I believe that is the correct worldview. In other words, that's reality. It's not a question of, well, that's your truth and this is my truth. There is the truth. It's not, you know, a big Rorschach test. There is a path that leads one to a good life and to heaven, and a path that leads one to personal destruction and in all likelihood, hell. And I'm certainly not, you know, didn't get brought up in a fire and brimstone kind of environment. I was brought up Unitarian, but I've come to realize these things are very important. Yeah, so I'm glad we talked about it, and the fact that it's in Common Core and it's in our public schools. You know, Agenda 21 is also a soft law that the United Nations passed back in 1992. Which is now in all our institutions, and it wants to redo the entire society along these kinds of lines. We need to know about Agenda 21, and now they call it Agenda 2030. And we need to get it out of this country. We need to go back to the Constitution and the Bible. And if we go back to the Constitution and the Bible, I'm sure we're good for another 200 or 300 years. But if we don't, we're not good for much longer.
That's exactly right. This has been fascinating to me, and we're going to do another topic. We're going to do one on Dallas. We're going to spread our ancient wisdom far and wide. But before we end this particular section, Eric, are there any topics that you'd like to lay on us before the end here?
Well, I would just say, since we're, you know, this is going to be a podcast, I'll just repeat my websites, 911nwo.com. You know, 2 + 2 = 4 in a world of rationality. But under the world of Big Brother, 2 + 2 = 5, 6, 7, 8. Yeah. So Big Brother tells us that Osama bin Laden did 911, and that's a preposterous proposition if you start to look into it. Obviously, if you get down to it, it's, you know, the CIA and the Mossad and Tavistock and MI6 and the power structure. So we have to decide whether we're going to let the mind controllers take away our ability to reason and agree that 2 + 2 = 6, that Osama bin Laden did 911. Of course, Osama bin Laden was a CIA asset back in the 80s during the war that the United States cooked up, a proxy war in Afghanistan, between Afghanistan and Russia, Soviet Union at that time. And, you know, he's a rich Saudi, part of a very rich family that's done a lot of business with the Bush family over the decades.
Right.
So his name was Tim Osman, CIA handle. So, you know, Osama bin Laden is the boogeyman. He's the patsy. He died right after September 11, 2001, of kidney failure. I mean, anybody can find this stuff out if they're, you know, go
just
on
look.
My website or hundreds of others.
Yeah.
Another website I have is naturalclimatechange.us. And again, the powers that be want us to believe that 2 + 2 = 4 and that by or 8,
uh-huh.
By driving around in our cars, you know, and burning fossil fuels that emit a little CO2, tiny, tiny trace amounts, that we're destroying the earth. Nothing could be further from the truth. CO2 is absolutely required for photosynthesis.
Yeah.
And a little bit more CO2 makes plants grow a little bit better.
Right.
Now, carbon monoxide, on the other hand, is a pollutant, and there are other pollutants. But we're being told things that make us stupid. And I was
yes.
a university professor for 30 years. I taught climatology. I've taught geology, earth science. I've taught quaternary environments, which is the ice ages. So I know something about climate change. And I know that we're being given a pack of lies that come out of an environmental movement that's created at think tanks like the Club of Rome and the yeah. report from Iron Mountain. So, I mean, if we look into these things, we'll see who the people are that are giving us these lies and why they hold on to them. What they're all cover stories that protect the realities.
Right.
We have a nation run by the CIA, and then spies always have a cover story, and they, you know, that we have a nation that's run by spies, by CIA guys.
Yes.
And they're giving us cover stories. So 9-1-1, the cover story is that Osama bin Laden did it. It's not true, but we want you to believe it.
Right.
Cover story behind, you know, any weather event that happens is, well, it's your fault because you burn
yeah.
fossil fuels. Well, they want to control our economic activity and deindustrialize America. And they want to control the fact that, you know, they want to make us think that we're destroying the earth. And so you know, out of guilt, we will,
right.
you know, pay these gigantic carbon taxes and, you know, all this stuff that will make them rich, of course, richer Al Gore and Maurice Strong and all those guys. Well, this is, you know, making us stupid. And smart people should be able to look these guys in the face and say, you know, this is a bunch of baloney. This
yeah.
is nonsense. These are lies. And then on my other website for music is erickarlstrom.com. And when I have on the water issues in my own San Luis Valley, Colorado, it's called waterwatchalliance.us. And there again, I run into Maurice Strong. Maurice Strong shows up in two of these websites prominently. That's the UN, or the, you know, he's the UN guy that set the terms of reference for the global warming fraud and all the funding for nations doing in climate research. That's coming from nations that are agreeing with the UN, you know, IPCC nonsense reports that they come out with every 5 years or so. This train of global warming has been coming down the track since the 60s. When the report from Iron Mountain think tank thought, well, we could use this as a substitute for war.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so anyway, these are lies. The documents are there to prove that they're lies. The science is there to prove they're lies. I hope people will wake up. I hope people will listen to Paul's podcasts on this kind of thing. We are trying to wake up, and we're seeing lots of positive signs that people are waking up. So on that note, I appreciate very much having the opportunity to talk about these very interesting topics. Music, I think, is something we both very much connect to and
yeah.
in our histories personally and in our culture's history.
Hey, thank you very much, Eric. It's been wonderful being with you, and we're gonna do the Alan Dulles one coming right up here.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Thank you, Paul and Mindy. Okay.
Bye-bye.
You guys have a great day. Bye-bye.